Hi, it's Larry here of Xbox Live's Major Nelson. Welcome to show number 606. We're in September. I've got we've got a fun show ahead of you. Ahead for you, we've got Laura here. Hi, Laura.
Hello.
Across from you is an empty desk or an empty position. Jeff is en route. He's going to do as any good multiplayer would. He's going to join in progress. Mm-hmm. So he's going to join us in progress. And then sitting also at his own station over there on mic number three is Mr. Graham Boyd. Hi, Graham.
Hello.
Long time friend of the show. We've had you on frequently, but it smells like you may be on more frequently.
Yeah, I'm sorry. It smells like
it. Well, I was just going to say you've
what are you trying to say?
You've moved over from the UK.
That's right. This is the first time I've been on the podcast where I'm not rushing off to a flight to the UK.
Because this is now your home.
Yes, I've made the move.
I'm now
a Redmond local.
Yeah, you are a Redmond local. So congratulations and welcome.
Now, thank you.
I want to talk a little bit about that before we get into the news and what we're playing and all that stuff. Because there's been some chatter on Twitter. They're like, oh my God, you know, Graham's leaving the UK. What's going to happen? I mean, you're actually moving over here to be more effective over there. I know it sounds weird, right? Would that be a way to put it?
That is a good way of putting it. Okay. I mean, yeah, you know. So yes, I've moved over here now.
You
so
moved
I'm
your family over, your
UK
boys.
The whole yeah, thing. it's like a proper move. So yeah. we all arrived last week, which is really exciting. I think part of the issue is that I didn't actually tell anyone like on Twitter or whatever until about 2 days before we moved, just because we had so much going on, you know, through the summer.
Well, I had a big surprise I dropped as well.
Well, indeed, I know. We were joking, weren't we? This is like the personal edition of the podcast. We're talking about all our personal news. You know, I wanted to get through Gamescom because we had so much going on at Gamescom before I kind of, you know, made it public that I was coming over here.
Yeah.
But, you know, and I think, you know, I've seen a few people tweet me and were like, oh, you know, it's a shame that you're leaving the UK and you're leaving Europe and stuff. And I just like, I want to clarify, like, actually what my role is and what I do at Xbox. And I want to reassure people that, like, I am certainly not turning my back on UK or Europe, and Xbox definitely isn't, or the rest of the world as well. So, you know, my role for the last sort of 18 months has been on the global Xbox social media team. I've always really worked
Which is a corporate way of saying you've worked on the social media team, but that team is really, for the most part, based over here in the Seattle area, right?
But that team's remit is global.
Right.
So all around the world, everywhere that we do social media is part of what we look after. Now, my role specifically is kind of split into two areas. So part of it is I focus on console and accessories.
Right.
So every time we've got new consoles coming out, new accessories, controllers, etc., I'm responsible for that work showing up on our social media channels, which is awesome because I love
all those pretty pictures you see on the Xbox Instagram and all the rest of that stuff. That's you.
I love it so much that, you know, I do it for the official Xbox social channels, and then on my own social channels, I kind of do it as a hobby as well.
Right.
So I love all that. And then the other part of my job is to look after international social media for Xbox. So I work with all of our Xbox teams all around the world, every market that we have Xbox in, to help them with their social media content.
Yeah.
And that's, I love that. It's fascinating because you learn so much about different countries around the world, how they engage with social media,
what works, what doesn't work. And it's always interesting to find out what works in, you know, Japan that works in the UK versus what works in Russia or whatever.
100%. Yeah. And we'll notice that there'll be pieces of social media content that will work universally everywhere.
Yeah.
And then there'll be strange pieces that will go amazing in some markets, like in Latin America or whatever, and maybe Australia, but won't play in other markets as well.
So and vice really, versa, yeah.
It's really fun to look after all that. Now, none of that changes for me.
Yeah.
Right. I've moved. I live in a different
country
now.
You physically have moved.
Yeah, I'm not in the UK anymore, but I'm still essentially doing that same role and looking out for those same things. So, I think, you know, the way you put it, Larry, was good, is that I'm really excited to be here in Xbox HQ globally.
Yeah.
As an international voice, another international voice here to kind of, you know, to be in the room and say, what about Europe? What about Latin America?
Sure.
What about Australia, New Zealand? What about Greater Asia? And, you know, markets outside of the US.
And I want to be clear is that everybody on the team, we all think globally, but you know, Laura and I have grown up in the United States, in very different parts of the United States.
That's true.
But, you know, you bring in, you know, I don't know about you, Laura, but in Texas, you know, I didn't have a lot of exposure to people, to non-US citizens.
Right.
You know, and so in Connecticut, I didn't. I don't know, but, you know, so it's great to have when you come work at a multinational company with a company that has a brand that goes around the world. It's great to have voices like yours, Graham, who can kind of, wait a minute, this is actually, I even noticed a difference. I'm sure you did, Laura, when you moved to Seattle from Texas. When I moved from Connecticut to Seattle, it's like, whoa, things are a little different out here. Wait a minute, that's not really, you know, I remember I had this conversation around summer. because summer in Seattle, they don't think it ends until October. Mm-hmm. But in New England, it's like right after Labor Day, which is the beginning of September, summer's gone. We're back to school. It's autumn now, even though maybe the calendar may be a little different. So anyway, I digress.
Well, the weather's nice this week, isn't it? Well, thank you for organizing that for me. A nice week of first weather.
Well, welcome.
Yeah, so I just want, and I want to reassure people that like there are amazing Xbox teams, particularly in Europe.
Oh yeah,
which is where a lot of the people have been saying to me, "Oh, what about Europe? What about Europe?" We've got amazing Xbox teams all around the world, and especially in Europe. And our focus is still squarely on that. I mean, if you look at what we did at Gamescom in Germany, and the reveal of Project Scorpio Edition, pre-orders for that, and all of the great news that came out of Gamescom, I think that's an indication of how important Europe and other regions around the world are for us.
So there you go.
And then of course we've got EGX coming up in the UK next week. I was looking at the plans.
Are you going back for that?
No, unfortunately. for one reason or other, I never get to go to EGX.
Yeah.
It's such a shame because that show is ace. I love it. It's sort of like the PAX of the UK because you get, you know, real gaming fans there.
Right.
And it's really the first time in the UK generally that people get hands-on with the new games. The new hardware.
Those coming up in the holiday,
So for us, it'll be the first time in the UK that real gamers, Xbox fans are getting hands on with Xbox One X. I've definitely been.
Okay.
But it's always like, I think I was it last year I was there just briefly for a day and did
where
some
is it?
Stage
where is
stuff.
It held?
It's in Birmingham.
It's in Birmingham.
At the NEC. So it's easy for people to get to. Our booth looks ace.
Yeah.
There's a ton of Xbox One X there. We've actually got more Xbox One X playable there than we have Xbox One S and PC combined. So it's a great opportunity to get hands on with X. Loads of games there and some really cool stuff happening as well. The booth looks great this year. It's a bit like, you know, our Gamescom booth looked really cool and therefore made the whole experience more fun. It's kind of the same at EGX.
Great job on Gamescom, by the way.
It was fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, we had a really good year this
year. I missed
you
guys.
But we missed you.
Yeah, we'll talk about that later.
Everyone is asking, where's Larry?
Well, now you know. The secret's out. We'll talk about that later.
Yeah, we couldn't tell anyone. We're like, oh, he's busy. so that's good. And then Paris Games Week, of course, coming up in France really soon. And then, of course, we'll have a ton of great stuff happening around the Xbox One X launch around the world as well. So
it's weird because, you know, we've had you on the show before, right, Laura? We usually have like three or four times a year when you come over. But now you're here and it's great to have you. So this feels very natural. Now, there has been, is he going to be the fourth person on the podcast? And, you know, I don't know. We haven't decided that yet. We're still in the trial phase. You know, to be honest with you, Laura has to approve you.
I think you'll have to. I'll put you in touch with my agent, Laura.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, bribery does work for me.
Oh, does it? Okay, that's good to know. That's interesting. But you know, it's a funny thing as well, like about my role. Like, I think a lot of people assume that me and you, Larry, work together.
Yeah, we're the same thing.
Like, all the time.
Right. Which we do, but it's not the way people think we do.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I wish we worked together more.
Yeah.
But actually, we kind of sit in different parts of the business, right? And sometimes we get these great opportunities to work together at events and
Gamescom and E3, right?
But yeah, you know, it's always interesting to... Like sometimes I talk to people about what they think my job is.
Right.
And it can be interesting hearing like how different it is to what
do. The way I always describe it is, you know, your job and our job and Laura, you as well, you know, people see what we do publicly, you know, the podcast and PAX and the events, but there's a whole other part of our job that we can't talk about. We can eventually.
Yeah.
Like when we were planning Xbox One X, I obviously couldn't talk about that until we revealed it.
Totally.
So there's all these other parts that we work on quietly. I meet with the product teams all the time and say, hey, why are we doing this? Or how about this idea? So there's this whole part of the other job that kind of rolls up to this public conversation, I guess.
100%.
Anyway.
But hopefully we will get to work together a bit more now.
I hope so. We're in the same building.
Now that you're close.
I do want to just level set a few things right away. Is that, you know, we're in a different building. You and I are in building 37. Laura hasn't even been over to see me in that building, which is on the other side of campus. True story.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
To see you. But I have been to 37, but you weren't around.
You avoided him.
Yeah. So
snuck in.
We were over there. But yeah, so it's you're welcome to come. Maybe Graham will, you know, come. And I also want to point something out is that I really appreciate you coming on the show and squeezing us in between your annual leave.
Yeah. And semi bad news is that there isn't really annual leave.
Yeah, there isn't annual leave.
I know.
So you're going to have to.
That was that was definitely in the cons column.
Yeah, exactly.
I was like, I just can't take 8 months of the year off. I don't know what I'm going to do.
What are you going to do?
Everyone goes on about annual leave to me on Twitter now as well. You've made that actual thing.
And you know the people that are responsible for that are in this room, specifically me, because we're always busting
all the time.
So I have to start calling it vacation now.
So
anyway, going on vacay.
Vacay.
Yeah.
It's okay. You can call it holiday.
Okay. No, I'm gonna. There's certain things I want to keep a hold of,
yes.
Like my accent, and then words like holiday.
Well, and your and leave. Your and your style.
And my style as well.
Yes.
Thank you. That's very kind of you to bring that up. Yeah.
Anyway, well, welcome. We'll have you on the show as frequently as you'd like. You know, maybe you want to come in here and, you know, give us some of your secret Instagram stories.
Thank you.
Instagram by Graham.
Instagram.
Instagram. Instagram.
Yeah. No, that's very kind of you. I might take you up on that. But anyway, people want to hear from
so yeah, we're here. We had, you know, Laura and I and Jeff, who will be here. He should be here probably any minute. He's actually landing. He landed from New York. He was out in New York all week, and he's going to come in right from the airport. So he's gonna hot seat this.
Wow, that is a rushed dream.
But yeah, you and I, we did PAX with Jeff.
We did
from
it's been a while.
We had a great Cuphead experience. Mikey Barr joined us. Did you get a chance to watch that stream?
I've watched some of the streams. Okay. I don't think I saw that one, no.
Yeah, that one was, it was a lot of fun. Cuphead was a lot harder than a lot of people thought. Mm-hmm. Cuphead's coming up later this month. You've seen the artwork, right?
Oh, 100%. Yeah. I mean, we had it on the show at Gamescom as well. It's absolutely amazing.
Yeah, everybody loves that. So
it's tough.
We had Cuphead on. We had Mikey Barr came on. We talked about some of the new features coming to Xbox One. We talked about a little bit of that, little sneak peek at what's coming up for those of you that are getting an Xbox One X later this year, the smooth transfer procedure, which is kind of cool. So, yeah, it was a good show. But we took August off because we had Gamescom. Laura, you went on holiday, right?
I did go on holiday.
Do you want to talk about where you went? I mean, I don't know where you went.
I went to England and to Italy.
Oh, nice. So where did you go in England?
European vacation. To London and Manchester.
Excellent.
And then the Lake District. Oh, so all over.
It's so nice.
It's really good.
Well, you know, it could have been better. You could have gone to Scotland, but England's okay.
I was really close.
Yeah, you were. You were very close.
And well, you had that travel. We had Gamescom, of which we'll get into that now. Mm-hmm. You know, I couldn't go to Gamescom because it was finally revealed that we revealed at PAX is that I have a baby girl now.
Yay! Congratulations.
Thank you very much. I'm, you know, of course, I told you guys months and months ago, and I like, because I remember did I tell you at E3 or did I pull you before that?
I think it was E3. Yeah,
yeah, I pulled you aside and I had
to. Yeah, it was. You know what? It was in Phil Spencer's green room at E3.
Oh, that's right. Wow. That's right. I pulled you in and I
what
said,
a moment.
I said, hey, Graham, I can't go to Gamescom this year. And because everyone I work closely with, because when I wasn't at Gamescom, everyone exactly had the response, why isn't he here? And I told Phil, obviously, I told you, and I told the people that were involved with this so that you could have the context. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't like, oh my God, it's wrong. So, and of course, I told Laura and Jeff many months ago. So I want to thank you guys for all your support. And everybody on Twitter said some nice words. I'm very proud. You know, she's a lovely, beautiful little girl.
She is the cutest.
Amazing.
Yeah, her name is Waverly Emma. So Waverly Emma Herb. So she's a...
What is the background on Waverly?
You know, I there really isn't. My wife... is an expert at naming and branding,
yeah,
for lack of a better term, and she came up with that. Turns out there's a little bit of story that was accidental, in that if we've all seen the movie The Princess Bride,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, apparently in the book, Buttercup and Wesley had a baby, and the baby's name is Princess Waverly.
Oh, nice!
So I didn't even know this. I'm sure my wife did because she reads a lot more than I do. But yeah, so other than that, it was just a beautiful name. So we call her Wave.
Someone on Twitter reminded me that there's a Waverly train station in Edinburgh.
Yes.
And they wondered if that was the inspiration.
That is not.
It is a nice train station.
That is nice. But anyway, so I want to thank...
that's the stop if you're going to watch Hearts play, Heart of Midlothian. You get off at Waverly and walk down the Gorgie Road to the stadium. So,
did you understand any of that, Lark? Anyway, that's my news, and I'm not going to be that guy who's flooding everybody with photos of my child, and I don't want
to
bother everybody.
Well, please send them to us, at least.
You're very kind.
Super cute.
She is super
so
cute.
Anyway, so that's the big news. I've been obviously sitting on that one for more than 9 months. We're very excited about that. But back to work. We've got Xbox One X launching later this year. We have this Project Scorpio edition, which so when did you see that video I did?
Like the day before? With the gloves. With the gloves. The gloves are amazing.
I haven't seen it. What are you talking about?
So I did the Project Scorpio unboxing. And
were you wearing white gloves?
Yes. So what happened was we shot that about a week before because I knew that, you know, that was I think the last thing I did before I went off and we had the baby. And I went into the lab. I don't remember what lab it was. It was one of the ones on the other side of campus with the big robots and they build hardware and, you know, they kind of do all this prototyping.
Oh, nice.
And they had this beautiful table set up and I said, hey, I'd love to do it with white gloves. And like, oh, and they had this whole collection of different white gloves. I look like Mickey Mouse.
What?
Or I look like Cuphead. Because I wanted to bring it out, because when you're showing off new hardware, you don't want to get it, you know, fingerprints or anything, even regardless of what it is, always gets fingerprints on it. Mm-hmm. So it just apparently created quite a storm when I held them behind and then I revealed them and it was like, what? So
everyone loved the gloves. So I'm intrigued by the person who has a collection of white gloves.
Well, I'll tell you, when you go into a hardware lab, they have a lot of very strange things. Yeah, so that was really what it was all about. But yeah, I was able to be the part of the show in my own special little way. And thank you for having me there. But the Project Scorpio edition, which now is sold out.
Yeah.
Sold out.
Yeah.
If you got a chance to pick one up, you are going to be very lucky. You've seen it, Laura, with the beautiful green on the front. And it's the one thing that's unfortunate is that the beautiful finish on the front of it doesn't come across well in video or photos.
That is very true, yeah.
It's so, I mean, we did the best we could do, but you got to really see it to believe it.
But in a way, that's quite nice, because when people actually get it and unbox it, they'll get the real effect of that kind of for the first time.
Yeah.
So it'll be like, it's like another.
I do want to be very clear is that white gloves not included. You're on your own there. It's the white glove edition.
There's a line of apparel there for you.
Is there?
To be.
You think of my unboxing gloves? Wow. Oh, you think you're right.
Major Nelson
official unboxing gloves.
Yeah, I think so.
There might be an opportunity
we
there.
We should have some conversations about
that. Yeah, we'll talk to some folks on that. There's money to be made there. Yeah.
No, but it was genuinely lovely to have you on the show, even though you weren't there in person.
Yeah, and I watched the show. You know, it was you had Julie on and...
Maxi
from Germany. Yeah. She's so great. Yeah, you guys had a great time. And
it was a lot of fun.
The set looked good. I was sitting in the hospital watching it.
Really?
Yeah, I was in the hospital. And then the nurses are like, what are you watching? Shh. watching Graham's and Maxie.
Surely you had more important things to worry about.
So, but the show looked great. We had a great show over there. It's always that. Laura, you haven't been to Germany yet.
I have not.
Oh, no. You simply must. How was the temperature this year? Because it's always.
It was nice.
It was always blazing hot there.
Do you know what? It wasn't really hot, but the weather was really good and it was pleasant.
Yeah.
So it wasn't like that horrible, sticky, sweaty heat. For the most part. I mean, there was a couple of moments.
Yeah.
But no, it was nice. It was really nice. And I love it. Cologne's such a nice city, and it's nice for going for runs and just getting some fresh air.
You and I just remember four or five years ago when we walked to the top of the Dom. Remember that?
Yes.
That was a great time.
I was reminiscing about that.
Yeah.
And then we passed the restaurant where we had a nice lunch together.
The with the meat sweats.
The Schlachter Platter. Do you remember that? I ordered this plate.
It was about the size of this table.
it was humongous. Finished the whole thing.
You did?
Yeah, I was proud of him.
Impressive.
Yeah, no, I don't know how many steps the Dom is, but it's. I just remember it is uniquely European. In that over here in America, you know, they've always got very clear markings of up and down. This is medieval.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like we're going up and down in the same staircase of which it's maybe 2 feet wide.
It was tiny.
Right? Yeah. And you're tinier than I am. I had a difficult time with my American girth.
Well, remember, it was worse going down, wasn't it? Because there's more of a sense going down that if you trip, you're gone. Yeah, like you were rattling down that whole spiral all the way. And yeah, it's so close. But it feels like a lot of stairs when you're, directly behind someone the whole way up.
So, you know, as we talked about at the top of the show, joining us in progress.
Hello.
Direct from
hello.
I started the show, Jeff, letting everybody know this is like a good multiplayer game where you join in progress.
Yeah, I love the idea that I flew 2,500 miles to be here for this show.
Yes,
and I'm still shown up. still not far enough.
Yeah, he's here.
Well, Graham.
And speaking of Cologne,
yes.
Cologne's playing Arsenal, like, right as now. We speak.
Oh,
yes.
What's the score, do you know?
I haven't looked yet.
I think they delayed the kickoff.
Here we go,
because they were waiting for me to land.
There's so many Cologne fans in London
for this
game.
Yeah.
There's video of them, of all these Cologne fans going through the middle of London, and it's like a horde of them. It looks amazing. They're all singing. And
they're sponsored
time.
By my favorite supermarket.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Reva,
I think, yeah.
Yeah,
I know that supermarket.
Yeah. You're darn right you do. It's the best one in town.
They engaged Jeff on social media.
They did, actually.
That was well
impressed. We had a whole discussion about... I play favorites with German supermarkets. I don't know about... I know you have to stay above the fray, Larry.
Well, anyway, welcome back, Jeff. You were in New York. You were doing some Xbox One X work in New York, right?
Yeah.
Can you talk about that at all?
I can, yeah. We've been showing Xbox One X. I know you're looking at my hair. It's a mess. I've been up since 4 in the morning.
Absolutely wasn't. Don't do that to yourself.
Oh,
at least you've got hair.
Well, for now. So I've been showing Xbox One X and tons of games in 4K, stuff from Forza, which is... Forza 7, which makes me very glad I bought a 4K TV, to games that are going to be enhanced for Xbox One X, like Gears of War 4, Halo Wars 2, Rise of the Tomb Raider, spent a lot of time with Cuphead.
Nice.
We were just talking about our PAX panel.
And actually, I got to see Craig Duncan and spend a day with him yesterday and play.
He's in New York.
What he came in just for that, he's already back in Blighty, I believe.
Whoa.
I probably played Sea of Thieves for about 3 or 4 hours.
Now, what's funny is I always have this Sea of Thieves, this affinity for Sea of Thieves for a lot of reasons. It's a fun game. I love Rare. But I remember a long time ago, Jeff and I went, mm-hmm. I don't know what building, we went up to the top floor with Craig and we played like as wireframes, you know, really early version of it.
Yeah.
Did you go too Rare to do that?
No, we did it here. We did it here.
Yeah, it's one of those things where Larry lifted up the velvet rope and I was like, but it was so early. It was amazing. But even then you could feel like they had something good there.
Yeah.
Like forget about the visuals and all that. It was gameplay fun.
And it was. What they didn't have though at that point was what we've seen already, which is the incredible water.
I knew you were going to bring up the water. Really
it is. I'm sorry. I'm obsessed with this water.
It is. So too, I guess, are the PUBG developers. And I played a bunch of that too.
Oh boy. Nice. So you've been busy. So all that news is going to come out in the future. Right?
Yeah. Another week or so, you'll start to read. We've got one more stop on this this media tour, and then you'll start to see all the stories that were written.
What was the buzz? What were people like? What can you say about what people were saying? What was the reaction?
You know, people really enjoy getting a hold of Cuphead. Mm. That was, I think, the only stop on this tour that we had. I'm sorry, Sea of Thieves. Cuphead, everyone was playing. It's beautiful.
Coming out at the end of the month.
Very soon we'll be playing that one. Forza, of course, looks beautiful. And people definitely gravitated towards PUBG. I think there might be something to that game, kids. Yeah. You heard it here first.
It's going to take off, I think, that one, isn't it?
Only 10 million sold in 6 months or whatever it is.
You know, I played it. I think we haven't talked about it. Have you played it, Graham?
Yeah, I played it a few times.
Okay.
But I bought my own copy.
So did I.
Like 2 days ago or something, yeah. So.
Laura, have you played it at all?
I haven't played it yet.
So I played it and I got to number 3.
Nice.
That's pretty
what does that
good.
Mean?
That means, Jeff, I'll
let you explain. So it's a battle royale type of game. These are starting to become, it's sort of like an offshoot of like, sort of like how Counter-Strike was initially an offshoot of... Oh, I can't remember God. At this
Half
point.
Life?
Nah, Half-Life I can't remember. Initially? Might have been. Yeah, that's I think sorry. It might. Yeah, yeah. And so it's
the
one
internet
of,
will correct.
Yeah.
You. Don't
so
worry
it's
about
it. It's one of these games that distills like the fun elements of like an open world MMO shooter. And it's basically very much like the Hunger Games. 100 people are dropped in. Literally, you jump out of a plane over a map, and you say, "All right, this is where I want to go." And you hope that everyone else doesn't do it. You have nothing. You just have the clothes on your back, and you start looting through houses and buildings, and you know, hopefully, you find something good. And slowly, you are hemmed into a smaller and smaller area, and there's only one survivor.
Yeah,
and I was
number 3.
Oh, that's sweet. Wicked. So you were the
Third remaining. Yeah. And it tells
quite
you
good.
In the upper right. And it was quite good, but I also must say, I was running like crazy.
Yeah.
I don't think I got one. Oh, you have no idea.
A legitimate tactic, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
Just stay away from all the action and you can get down there. The thing that nobody warned me about was it's terrifying.
Oh, yeah.
Like
it's very tense.
It's one of the scariest games I've ever played because you hit the ground and you know straight away that if anyone's near you, they're gunning for you.
Yeah.
And if you can't find some decent armor or weapons or whatever,
you're in trouble.
You're just like, and there's those moments in there where you're like rooting through a house to find some stuff and you hear a gunshot.
And you're like, you just freeze.
Oh my God. It's terrifying.
Yeah. And then, of course, you just dump right back into the next one.
Yes,
so, which is
exactly.
A lot of fun. So, and the coming Xbox One later this year.
I think we said later this year. I don't think we've said anything else besides that, but I can't wait. Just cannot wait. I think it's going to be a
fun.
That was one of my best memories about Gamescom, again, was we had Brendan Green on the show itself delivering that news for the first time. He is such a nice bloke.
Oh, he is.
We
nice guy, too.
Yeah. He's so relaxed and like he's in the midst of this like absolutely mad travel schedule. Like if you follow him on Twitter, like every day he lives in Korea and then he's in Brazil and then he's in the US and then he's in Ireland and then it's just like nonstop. But he was so chill and he's like so humble about the whole thing and just like seemed so excited about where it's all going.
His life's changed just a bit in the last year.
100%. Yeah.
Well, he's got a lot going on. But yeah, we'll talk about that. Do you want to maybe get yourself settled in, Jeff, a little bit?
Sure, I'll do that.
Crack your laptop open.
All right.
You're
going to put me to work.
We're going to go through a little bit of news. I mean, it's been a month since we've been on. We've gotten together. Laura's been traveling.
Wow.
I have a +1 in my life. Mm-hmm. Graham has moved over. What's your big news?
I got a car. Oh, that, we'll talk about that later.
Yeah. I did too.
That's the first time I bought a new car since like 6 months after I graduated college. So
right.
Well done. It's been a while.
Yeah.
A very long while.
So we'll talk about that in our... I think that's...
Is it your new car that has the like biohazard filter?
Yes.
On the dash?
Oh, that's you.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I saw that and I was like, oh my God, that's end of days stuff, isn't it?
I prepare.
Yeah. And you used it.
Yeah, a lot.
Yeah.
We'll talk about that later in the show. We got a lot of news going on this week. I don't even know what to say. Destiny 2. Yeah. Have you guys?
What's your light level? Quick.
Well, listen, I'm just going to say straight away, I've been moving my whole family.
You're off the hook.
Off the map.
You're off the hook.
I did play a bit of Civilization 6 because the house was getting packed up.
That's a good one.
There was these...
One more move.
Well, it was amazing because like all these guys turned up to pack our house up.
Awesome.
And I felt like I've got absolutely nothing to do here. So I just booted up Civilization 6 and like played seriously about 7 hours straight.
I think that's the minimum recommended session.
And then you looked up and your house is empty.
Just that these removal guys like tutting at me, trying to get me to make
I've moved a couple of times. Laura, you've moved too as well. You stay out of their way. Do not get in the way of the professionals, man. Yeah. They know what they're doing and away they go.
Totally.
So Destiny 2, Laura, have you had a chance to check it out?
I have had a chance to play.
Yeah, and?
Yes.
What class are you playing?
So I am a warlock.
I knew it.
Can you guess what race?
No.
Is it race?
I don't know.
The Awoken.
Okay.
The blue ones?
Yes, the blue ones.
That's a good call.
Yeah, I know. They're really cool. And I've only played about 2 hours of it. Haven't had a chance too much to do
it. To what level are you?
But 2.
Okay. Yeah, I think I'm level 15. I'm getting towards the end game.
Oh, you're getting
I've been waiting
there.
For you.
I know.
We've
been sneaking in. So like when we were in San Francisco, like we had an hour break for lunch and immediately just booted up Destiny and started falling into these the public events.
Right.
And then you can make them into like a legendary public event. And nice. It's the earliest I've ever gotten a exotic.
Good for you.
I know. I'm pretty happy
awesome.
About
good
it.
For you.
But yes, I got a lot more work to do.
Destiny 2 is out on Xbox, Xbox One X. Check it out. Or Xbox One. Maybe I may or may not be playing on Xbox One X. I can't say.
Ooh, what a tease.
Can't say that. But yeah, we've got a lot of other news. Jeff, do you have the news open there? Do you want to
Yeah, I'm getting there. So just announced, we had this on tour. And so if you're looking, we're talking a lot about Xbox One X. If you're listening to this podcast, you might be in the market for it. But Xbox One S is, a huge part of what we do. And of course, every game you can play on X, you can play on S. And so a new bundle is out for that. And that is Forza Horizon 3 Hot Wheels bundle.
What? Yes.
You've played the Hot Wheels expansion on Forza Horizon 3. I think it's just amazing. There's so much of it that's fun.
It's the game I didn't know I wanted.
Exactly.
I think it's a brilliant idea.
Yeah. And the execution's so good, and just the plastic tracks look so shiny, and it's beautiful, and I've been playing a ton of it.
You know, for me, it's I've got two boys, right? Finley, the game that I will always remember with Finley is Lego Marvel Super Heroes.
Yes, that's I remember you playing that. Yeah,
it's Forza Horizon 3 Hot Wheels with Fraser, our 3-year-old, because it's the first time he saw a game, and he loves Hot Wheels anyway. He's got like a mad Hot Wheels collection. He saw that and he was like, ah. So we were actually playing it with Copilot, which again was the first time I'd properly used Copilot to play a game.
It's a great feature.
So he was on throttle,
mm-hmm.
just full throttle all the time.
Yeah.
That's how I've taught him.
Yep.
That's how he's going to live his life. And I was doing the steering. And it was amazing because we were just, we weren't doing any races or anything. We were just, tootling around the tracks, hitting the boosts and everything. We had such a good time. So yeah, very special. That's a nice bundle.
Yeah, that is. It's a great bundle. And some of the store, I know the Microsoft store was running, get the bundle and get a game of your choice for $279 US. So
free game.
Good.
Yeah, we always like that. So I know people love free games. So what's wrong with that?
Exactly. And you know what, right? I was talking about my role earlier.
Yeah.
If you want like a indication of the kind of things that I actually do in my day to day, if you look on the Xbox, Facebook and Twitter page today, we did this really cool image of the bundle box shot and actually built Hot Wheels tracks around it. And we've got some Hot Wheels cars on there and took photographs of it.
Let me be clear.
I was very heavily involved.
In case you haven't connected the dots, Graham has moved to the US and is being paid to build Hot Wheels tracks.
That's my dream
job. Did I capture that correctly?
That's pretty much it.
Okay. You know what? God bless you.
I do it all for you.
It's a great gig if you can get it. What else you got there, Jeffrey?
So this is something for those of you who are in like the preview program. And so you're getting early looks at the Xbox One's system software. And so you may have noticed that we're making some improvements to game DVR. And I think some of the folks in those early alpha rings are starting to see that as part of the Insider program. And so previously, game DVR was limited to 720p, 30 frames a second, but now we're bumping it up to 1080. So that's nice. Something.
More P's.
Yes. More P's is always good.
Mm-hmm. You're also, by the way, we're also allowing in the alpha ring to let the people use, store their clips on an external drive. So,
very good.
Yeah.
Basically, use it, your Xbox One as a camera.
And there's some other cool features that are coming soon that I can't really talk about. Oh, there's the headline. I just made the headline.
Gosh. Larry, you walked right into that one.
That's the one I was telling you about.
Oh, yes.
Right? So, anyway, we'll talk about that.
I'm still getting used to my light mode.
I know.
My light.
Your theme?
Theme. Nice. Thank you very much. It really lights up the whole room. Nice touch. Yeah. I didn't mean it to sound so trite, but it really does. So this is something that I was very excited. So we were talking about battle royales, mm-hmm. and while we're waiting for PUBG to come out, Fortnite has announced a battle royale mode coming. So it's coming September 26th, so another not even 2 weeks to Xbox One. And I have a friend who had tried it out. I guess there's some test servers or something like that. So that's pretty darn cool. Mm-hmm. So Fortnite has some great mechanics. As you know, it's a game that is also in sort of like a preview mode right now, but the main mode is building and then surviving sieges of zombies. This is a very different look with, I believe, 100 players on one giant map. So I'm looking forward to getting into that one.
Yes.
To brush up for PUBG.
Do you think it's the next big genre?
I mean, we're seeing quite a bit. I think there will be. The Calling, I believe, was actually the first one to hit Xbox One. That's in preview program right now, in game preview. And I think that came out in like April or May. And that one's a little bit smaller. I think there's maybe 24 people. And it's a little more melee based. But I think you're going to start to see. I mean, this is just my speculation. But when there's like a trend and people are all over it, I mean, everyone's paying attention right now.
It is. It's a great mechanic though, isn't it? It's surprising that, because I guess it got big in movies and stuff, what, 5-10 years ago?
Yeah.
The whole battle royale thing.
Yeah,
well, and actually there was Battle Royale, the Japanese movie, which I watched as a teenager.
Did you?
Yeah, that's like 20, you know, that's a long time ago. Unfortunately,
at the little cinema in Scotland.
No,
in Aberdeen.
I got it in, you know, it was a cult classic. I got it on VHS. It was,
old school.
Yeah. Remember those?
Oh, I do, with the tracking and the whatever that was.
How far we've come. But yeah, it's a good genre for gaming, isn't it? And like you made the point earlier about Battlegrounds, that dip in, dip out.
Yeah.
Like, if you're out the game, straight back into
you know,
the
and a lot of games, a lot of other folks,
like,
a lot of other folks are kind of tapping into that. For instance, Grand Theft Auto has a new mode, which is very battle royale.
Yes.
Yeah.
So you've got the sandbox of Grand Theft Auto, which is extraordinary.
Yeah.
And then this layered on top of it. So perfect, what else you got there, Jeffrey?
Yeah, a couple of demos available now. So it's when all the sports games come out. Madden, of course, has been out for a little bit.
By the way.
Yeah, you've got, we need to play.
Jeff and I, last year, we played it for the past couple of years. We play, it's a Patriots versus Eagles.
Oh, right.
And I've been asking him for 2 weeks.
Yeah, we could probably play on Saturday. I think it'd be good. Before I hit the road again, and then you can just toss the ball up to Gronk over and over and over again.
Hail Mary. Hail Mary. Hail Mary. Hey, Hail Mary.
It did work, and it wasn't really fun to play against.
I promise I'll only do those once.
Well, I have some receivers this year, unlike the past couple.
Okay.
So get ready for some Alshon Jeffrey. Great name. So there's an NBA 2K18 demo of called the Prelude, and they did this last year as well, where you get to play the story mode. The create a character, you can do that. You can sort of get a jump before NBA 2K18 comes out. I believe if you pre-order it, you should probably, by the time you hear this, be able to play it. But the release date for everyone else will be on the 19th, so next week. FIFA 18 also has a demo that's out right now. That may be, you're nodding a little more vigorously for that one, Graham, than you were for NBA.
Proper football.
And so that one, despite having Ronaldo on the cover, who I'm just not a huge fan of. I'm still excited for
Jeff Rubenstein on Twitter. If you have any issues, you can take that up with him there.
I think the world's richest football player will somehow, I think, because, well, first of all, he played for Man U, bit of a showboat.
Okay,
if I had to choose between Cristiano Ronaldo and Messi, it's Messi all day long.
Back to proper
I don't
video
forget
games.
These things. Now, yeah, of course. But, well, anyway, so the thing about FIFA 18, there's like, if you get the Ronaldo edition, and it really hurts
well,
me
I'm sorry,
to say
what's
that.
The edition?
Yeah, you get to play it earlier. So I'm going to be getting the Ronaldo edition. I believe you get to play it on the 26th if you get the Ronaldo edition. And of course, EA Access will give you 10 hours of play before that.
Right.
So we'll be talking
and
about that.
And you have EA
next
Access,
week.
Right?
Of course I have.
Why wouldn't you?
And that starts 21st, right?
I believe it's the 21st.
So
something
Xbox
around
is the first
time.
Place you can play FIFA 18.
Yep. And the only place you really want to.
Mm-hmm.
Where else are you going to play against
Indeed.
Me?
Indeed. Can't wait Throw to see Ronaldo how Aberdeen are getting rated this year. Should be up.
You're gonna, they're right, going to miss you.
All right.
They're going to miss
all right.
Something. I think we need to start a new podcast. I'm just going to say
yeah.
We might want to do that.
So,
and then there's also, so Larry's just to complete the sports, which is really just killing it, NHL 18, the Young Stars.
3v3.
Is now out. Yeah.
3v3 mode.
I know. I was always a big...
I played that.
Did you?
Yeah, I had a good time with it. I was actually pretty good with it.
Yeah,
that'd be fun.
I like the two button, one button to pass, flights? One to shoot.
It feels good. I mean, I want to play as my Hartford Whalers, but that's a whole other conversation.
Mm-hmm. Can you make Gretzky's head bleed?
I don't know.
That's a deep cut right there.
I saw a car registration plate with Hartford Whalers on it, just like yesterday.
Was it yours?
What's the story there?
I don't know. Mm. Where was that? Obviously
here. Yeah, yeah, it's on my drive to work.
Wow, I don't know. Hartford Whalers.
Are they an old?
They're a defunct. They were in the, they used to be the New England Whalers. I think it was a Hartford, then New England. It was a hockey team in Connecticut, and then Connecticut's economy basically tanked, and they moved, they rebranded the team and moved into North Carolina, became the Hurricanes.
All right.
And that was 96, 95, somewhere.
Yeah, somewhere in the, right about that time.
Yeah.
And I think they won.
So that's when I lived there. And it was,
they won a Stanley Cup, didn't they?
I'm sure they did once.
I feel like they did once. Anyway, that should have been yours.
Well, you've got a soulmate out there somewhere locally.
I think I know. It may be KP from 343 because he's from Connecticut as well. Anyway.
You still have your Burger King Whaler. If that's what the fish sandwich is still called.
Is it?
It was. It was called the Whaler.
Wow, okay.
Made from
I'm really hungry. I've not eaten in 6. I had a cheese plate like 7 hours
you had seven
ago.
Kids, 7 bags of peanuts on the air, did you?
They don't even give you the peanuts anymore.
I know.
Larry, don't get me started on that.
Everyone's allergic to, don't get me going on that either. Go on Delta, they give you peanuts.
I'm not, I am a loyal Alaskan.
I know.
Yeah.
Well, then you'll have to do without the peanuts.
I'll have to do without the peanuts or buy them before I get on. Anyway, a lot of indie games also coming out this time. Just a ton, actually, really. But one I wanted to call out because big fan of the developer, which is Clay Entertainment. And Don't Starve Together console edition is now available. If you,
I was watching
you,
that
you don't want to start
earlier
alone.
Today, actually.
Oh, were you?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, there you go.
Glenn Gregory and where was playing it. It looks great.
We'll, you want to catch up on all the news, you just swing by my blog at majornelson.com. I'll have all the just easily browsable. You can follow me on Twitter at Major Nelson and all of, we'll let you know what's going on. The game deals, the bundles. Yeah, the pictures may not be as great as Graham's, but I'll do what I can.
It's a high bar to set.
It is. It is.
But,
you know what I did this week?
Hmm?
Shot a Taco Bell video.
I saw the I saw the snaps. Yeah.
So we were
with talking. with a guy I'm a huge fan of, Legion, Jordan Payton.
Jordan was
one
great.
Of the funniest guys I've ever met.
I don't want to say too much. You'll probably see it next week, but we had a good time with it. It was just to talk about, you know, the
$5 box,
the $5 box. Which have you gotten the $5 box, Graham?
No, I was bummed out because I was going to come to the shoot yesterday and then realized I had meetings.
You had real work to do.
Skip
yeah.
out on yeah.
Yeah.
But I assumed someone would bring me a $5 box back.
We ate them all.
Exactly.
I talked to Aaron Greenberg. He was doing that. So.
It's got a Doritos Locos Taco in it, and so it has my
Did
seal of approval.
Snaps?
Okay.
Did I send you snaps? I may have.
I don't have any snaps from you.
Oh, I got to tell you, I tend to be a little more active on Instagram than Snapchat. Instagram's UI is a little easier for me to understand.
Better engagement.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's follow me on Instagram if you will. That's probably.
I heard the quesarito is good too.
Anyway, we
would kill for quesarito. Right
we shot a bunch there and it was a lot of fun. We'll see that video next week. I'm sorry, I digress.
There. No, that's fine.
Shall we talk about what we're playing?
Oh, yeah,
about what we're eating.
We caught about
just,
Destiny
just
2 a little bit.
In.
What are you playing? Do you have your list, Laura? I can see your you know, Laura's one of the only ones that shows up prepared for this. Jeff doesn't show up sometimes
Graham
until 20
notes.
Minutes. Graham does
you
have notes.
You could have waited.
I
know.
I can't live without notes.
I could have waited, but I knew
you weren't going.
I knew that.
I'm
I knew
impressed.
That. I knew
Thank
that Graham
you.
And Laura had other stuff.
You run a tight ship, Larry. I get it.
On time.
Well, the preparedness. Let's check on the box.
Laura,
okay, good, yes.
Laura, you brought up what we're playing, so why don't you go ahead and indulge?
So I can't remember what happened before PAX, because that was ages ago. So I'm just going to start with PAX and move forward.
I'll tell you, if you were to say a year ago, this is what's going to happen during the month of April of PAX, or excuse me, the month of August of PAX, nobody would believe us.
Yeah, I know, right? It's crazy.
So
I wanted to chat about the games that we saw at PAX, because we didn't get a chance to do that on the show. So
yeah.
We were super busy with all the awesome stuff we had to talk about. Nothing about what we'd seen at PAX. And I think my favorite thing that I did was I played Sea of Thieves with Larry.
Oh, we had a great time.
Yeah, we got a chance to play together. We had a crew of four who was pitted against two other crews of four.
Yeah, our other two was just a couple of random folks.
Really nice folks. Yeah, really
Who sidled into the captain role?
It was Joe, wasn't it?
Well, Joe Neat, the producer,
yeah,
was walking us through. Fortunately, they had like a guide who would help you if you ever got stuck or explain the controls or, you know, if you couldn't figure out the puzzle. He would give you a hint.
And there was a situation where Laura couldn't figure out the puzzle. In fact, I don't think you've seen this, Laura. This is the this is the image of us playing with our fourth. So you can see Laura and I are on the left side, and mm-hmm. then
that's
a really good photo.
Yeah, isn't that a great photo?
Who did that for you?
Who did this? This was David. This is one of the producers.
Oh, nice.
So David Quinn did that.
Did you get to experience the new feature that has officially sold me on the game, if I wasn't already?
Sick in a bucket.
How did you know? How did you know? Yes. Bucket so puke.
Yes.
I don't. Well, it may that feature may have been in our game, but we were too busy trying to solve puzzles.
Yeah, well.
Well, I was the driver of the ship, or
you,
the captain.
We call them the captain.
Or if you know, you want to be like a pilot.
You did very well.
Thank you, but I had a great map reader.
Yes,
which was Larry.
Yeah, well, you and I have decoded many a map in real time, in real life, and in games.
Yes.
So it worked out well. It was pretty easy because it was like straight ahead, Laura, just straight ahead.
Keep going, doing well.
Yep.
But once we got to solving the puzzles,
things unwound
a little bit,
which was a little disturbing because you know, and
I will say, I think my compass was broken.
So there's this point where if you haven't played Sea of Thieves or if you haven't seen any of the hundreds of streams that have happened, there's puzzles that you can solve that are in the form of a scroll, and you do the first
riddle, isn't it?
Yeah, you solve the first part of the riddle, and then it reveals the second part and the third part, and so you're kind of led. So
and
Laura,
then it leads you to treasure. So it's essentially a pirate treasure map. You're trying to go under the island to find the treasure.
And one of them was we had to go to this particular fire.
So there were multiple things that required the compass.
Yes.
That's why I think my compass was broken.
Yes.
And I would always, so for example, one
was
of the
Was it like every,
puzzles,
way, every way you turned, it was always pointing the same way from
no,
north?
No, I think it was maybe 10 degrees off.
Ah, okay.
Because due south and found the southernmost tip of the island, because one of the puzzles is about getting to the southernmost beach of the island and then doing something. I don't remember what you had to do there.
Right.
Either like play a song or do a little dance. I don't remember. But I was there at the southernmost. Like my compass said, you cannot get more south than this.
Right.
And you were somewhere else and you're like, I found it.
That's right. That's right.
So that's why I think
my compass was
broken.
Well, and then to put a fine point on it, at one point in the riddle, we had to go to a fire.
We had to go to the center of the island.
And this particular fire pit.
And take seven paces.
Each. So I hear Laura. I see her character get there, and she does the seven paces, and she starts digging, and there's nothing. And I'm kind of like, with all due respect, based on what I had seen earlier, I had low confidence in your compass.
Yes.
So I went over to, I'm like, let me count this off myself. So I went over and I pull out my compass and seven steps, it was east. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, pull out my shovel. First dink. I hit the chest.
Oh.
So we dug up now the funny thing with that chest is it was cursed.
Oh yeah.
What?
It was cursed. So when you have to, so the deal, for those of you who haven't seen, you have to carry your chest back to your ship and then eventually take the ship into the
store,
turn it in.
And sell it back in.
But the chest was cursed and it would cause you to walk as if you were drunk.
Mm-hmm.
Oh nice.
So we're weaving, me and Laura and our two teammates are handing the chest off, weaving all over hither yon. We finally got the chest back, but
really?
it was good. Some good loot in that chest.
We found the treasure.
Yep.
After even the broken compass adventure?
All right, your broken compass adventure.
Yes, exactly. And we turned it in, and we got about 3,000.
Yeah, it was a lot. It was pretty good. So we had a lot of fun. That was just the first mission, I think, really the first mission that we did. So that was a lot of fun.
Walking around drunken kind of takes us back to the sick in a bucket. This is a legitimate feature in the game, though.
And perhaps the most legitimate feature in the game.
Yeah.
And what could are you?
So you have you come equipped when you spawn into the game with a mug, a tankard of grog, and at any point, you know, you have a moment or two, you can take a sip or a draft.
This is for the adults only
crowd. Big, yes. Say 21 and up, please. Or a big old swig, and If you clear your cup, your mug, and you go back downstairs, or if you're in a tavern, you can refill it. And if you have too much to drink, you learn a hard lesson.
Now
better it's now or you're going to learn it on the streets.
Now, it's interesting because I used the bucket, but I used it for bailing out the ship.
Yeah.
So this is a multi-purpose tool.
Yeah.
Similar concept, right?
Yeah, it's a fluid. It's in a vessel.
But when I was talking to Ted Timmons 2 weeks ago, I think, we did like the Game Store Managers Conference over in the UK, and he was talking through the feature, and he was saying it's got tactical implications, right? If you're sick in the bucket, you can keep that sick in a bucket, mm-hmm. carry it around with you. And if you get into combat, you can actually throw the bucket or throw the sick yep. from the bucket oh. at an opponent, which then blinds them.
Yeah, it clouds the screen with and green slime. Yeah. It's funny. Right before you said that, I was like, wait, I can use this for more than just shenanigans. But,
correct.
Yeah.
Tactical implications of sick in a bucket.
Yeah.
Disgusting.
All right.
Yeah.
Larry is plainly disgusted.
I did not know that. So
let's be honest, it's going to be the only game with a sick in the bucket feature for the foreseeable
while until they add that into PUBG or something.
Props.
Yeah. Or eating a banana.
Yes.
With the peel on.
Yeah.
Just straight in.
Taking a chunk. Mm-hmm.
Riva has taken the lead, and the play was just disgusting.
Rare put up a top 10 things you don't know about Sea of Thieves video, and I'm just kind of previewing it now with the sound down. I don't know if this bucket situation is in there. I'll have to find out. Anyway, so Laura, right. Getting back to you, yeah. Sorry.
So another thing that I was sad we didn't get to talk about in the show was I got one of those sweet Sea of Thieves tattoo sleeve.
Yes.
Oh, nice.
Which is just a funny story. I had seen pictures of the Sea of Thieves team in different events with these full sleeve tattoos, and I thought for sure that the lead producer Joe had actually gotten the sleeve
right.
tattooed onto his arm.
What it is, it's a flesh colored piece of fabric that yes. you slide your arm. It's a sleeve.
It's a sleeve.
And it's got tattoos on. So if you look quickly, you're right. It does look real.
It looks real. And for the eagle-eyed people at our panel, I was wearing one for the first half.
I didn't notice
you
that.
You didn't notice that, and then I took it off when we were standing up to play Cuphead.
And then you rode your Harley home.
I did. That's right. So I got one of those, which I was super excited about.
Nice. So if you see Laura at Bike Week in February,
Daytona Beach.
Tattoo, it's not real.
They have good swag, Sea of Thieves, in there. Have you got yeah. one of those, one of their notebooks?
No.
The sort of brown leather notebook.
Ooh, and it's
got, is that what you
really
have there?
Nice. It's No. I stupidly packed all of my good notebooks and put them in the air freight, so I don't get them for another couple of weeks. So okay. that's just a okay. box well, standard one I have to buy.
All right.
The other game I got to play at PAX was Shadow of War.
Yeah, we got you over to see Shadow yeah. Wars.
It was awesome. They let you play for 30 minutes, which was really, really fantastic. And I don't know if this is just the demo mode or if that's how the game is going to be, but they put you into an arena and you got to choose what type of mission you could do. And there was a new type of mission, which is new to Shadow of War, which is a siege of a castle.
Mm. Right.
And I got a chance to play that. And let me just tell you, it was really hard.
It's nuts, isn't it?
It's nuts. It's really hard, but of course, that's because I was a low-level character. I hadn't unlocked all of my awesome powers
sure.
yet. So.
Did you ride on anything?
And you get to spawn a warg.
Like oh, a okay.
warg,
so, all right.
But so, I didn't get a chance to ride on anything else.
Well, so I saw a siege that was made a little bit easier because you get to go full Daenerys. And ride on a dragon.
What?
And you get to go, you know, you basically say
watch
Dracarys.
Watch the spoilers.
You get to say Dracarys okay. and fry a bunch of orcs. And it's
so
awesome.
Good.
It's oh really, it's really, really cool. It looks amazing. And it's fun.
The thing about that fortress assault, though, is I played it at Gamescom. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, when you're playing Shadow of Mordor, you had you came up against the war chiefs and all, mm-hmm. you know, you had your nemesis and, you know, you'd have these battles and it was generally against one high level right. opponent, the war yes. chief or whatever. In those fortress assaults,
it's all of them.
You end up with like three of them on yes. you at one time. And it's just like a chain yeah. of, you've got to keep those combos going. But, yeah. but you've also got your allies, right? Mm-hmm. So it had some of these amazing new moments that I'd never seen before where I was downed and about to be decapitated.
Oh.
And one of my allies stepped in and saved me
yes,
by like
to me.
Executing the dude who was about to. And I was like, oh my God, this is amazing. And I was back up, you know, and they say a little word to you, oh, get up on your feet.
Let's go. Get back to action.
Yeah, exactly.
I was like,
oh my God, this is amazing. So it's like this 30-minute action mm-hmm. sequence that just keeps going and going and going and building and building. It was intense. It was mm-hmm. great
That's
fun.
When's that game come out?
October 10th.
October 10th.
Yeah.
So we're getting close.
Yeah.
Exactly. So
I will have an
do...
Xbox One S bundle for Shadow of
We will.
Shadow of War.
Yes.
My brain always does a little tick there. Yes. Shadow of Mordor, Shadow of War for Shadow of War. Yeah.
They sound so
500 gigabyte and 1 terabyte editions.
Yeah. So that was super fun at PAX. I'm very thankful I got a chance to try that out. The lines were so long, but it was definitely worth it.
Yeah.
You know, super a wee tip, cool. If anyone's listening, they get the chance to go hands-on with the demo. If when you start the demo, if you go into your inventory or your character screen or whatever, you've actually got a ton of power-ups stored up that you can add to your character.
That you can activate.
New, yeah, new abilities. And so you can kind of, you can choose which path you want in your character tree
who
for
knew?
That demo. So,
who knew?
So there you go.
That would have definitely helped fight War Chief after War Chief after War Chief. Because it seems like you fight them all in Siege.
Well, I mean, we talked about the games I played, and so I don't really have much to add here. I don't know if you, Graham, you played the move into the United States.
Yeah.
So achievement unlocked. Wait a minute. Have you been to Walmart yet?
Not Walmart.
Okay.
Target. Okay. Several times.
Okay, we've
been in about 78 different supermarkets in the 4 days we've been here.
We've got quite a few.
And we still haven't bought everything we need.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Every time we go in, something happens.
If you're looking for Jaffa Cakes, keep looking. If you find them, let me know.
Okay, I think I've got a lead on that, actually.
Oh, do you?
What are they talking about?
I think I've had a Jaffa cake.
You should.
What is it?
Delicious.
A Jaffa what?
It's like a cookie, but it has like a thin layer of orange marmalade and then chocolate on the top, and it's delicious. But the thing is, it's actually not that unhealthy for you.
What's the origin?
England? They're McVitie's. I'm sure you've seen that brand. They do a lot of stuff, and I can get a lot of that brand here, but I can never find Jaffa Cakes.
They don't have them down at that QFC in U Village? That really nice.
No, they don't. I believe they have like everything on that product.
Right.
They have canned bread. When does one eat canned bread?
It's at Walmart.
Whoa! Yeah, look at that.
Oh, okay.
They don't look like
speaking of Walmart
Jaffa Cakes.
Yeah, they look like some. Well, you know what?
There's a British shop near here, apparently.
Yeah,
what?
Yeah.
That's what I'm told.
Right. Yeah, there's one down in Redmond.
I bet they've got them. Because Jaffa Cakes are pretty...
Well, you're not British, though.
Well, what do you mean?
He's not English.
Scottish.
He is.
But, you know, they have Jaffa Cakes in Scotland as well.
Do they?
Yeah. I'm hoping they've got Iron Brew in this
I've never
shop.
Seen it, but maybe.
What?
Well, I haven't really... I've never had it.
All right.
You should bring some in for everyone.
You know, the debate about Jaffa Cakes, though, is the ongoing debate is whether it's a cake or a biscuit.
Okay.
And by biscuit, I mean, I guess, cookie.
It has a cakey sort of,
softer than a crunchy. Yeah.
What's that gentleman that always brings us chocolate at PAX East?
Oh, right. Yeah,
maybe he should bring some of these over. I can't remember his name. Apologies.
Yes.
Maybe he should bring some over this next year at PAX East. He can bring us.
Oh, yeah. He brought the dairy milks last year. That was awesome.
So extraordinary. Because that's unfortunately, Graham, I have some bad news.
Well.
The chocolate in the U.S. kind of blows.
Unless you like dark chocolate. They have great dark chocolate, even stuff that's made in town. Yeah. But the milk chocolate, nowhere near as good as it is in Europe.
Because I'd heard that, I brought a couple of big bags of Cadbury's for the people I'm sitting next to just to try and endear myself.
You can also go to Canada. You just drive
I'm
over the border.
Next to you.
Yeah.
I'm sitting next to you.
Well, you are now, yeah. You have to. They're all gone. Trust me, they got wolfed pretty quickly.
Okay.
I'm not a massive chocolate.
Anything else there, Laura?
I have one more funny story I want to share about
PAX. Please.
So, we all know I've played Thimbleweed Park.
Yeah.
And I talked about it on the show how I got stuck.
Yeah.
And I was just walking down in PAX and looking at all the indie games and came across the Thimbleweed Park booth in the indie mega booth.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw a bunch of people behind the booth. And so I thought I might say hello and introduce myself. And I walked up to the booth and there was a man standing there, older gentleman. He looked kind of familiar, but I'm like, okay. So I said, hello. Do you work for Thimbleweed Park? And he's like, why, yes, I do. I am the sole developer. And I was like, oh my gosh, are you Ron?
That's Ron Gilbert. Awesome.
He's like, yes, I am. I'm like, hi, I'm Laura.
Fangirl.
Hi, great game.
Just for the benefit of the listeners, Laura's actually going red.
Yeah, yes,
you never do that.
I was not prepared to have the developer at PAX.
That's amazing.
But before you get started, that's a classic PAX experience. Yeah. That happens all the time at PAX. That's the beauty of it. So go ahead.
Anyway, so we were chatting about the game, and I eventually said, I love a game, but I'm stuck.
Right.
Do you have any advice for how to get me unstuck?
Right.
And he said, did you know there's a helpline in the game?
Said, seriously.
No.
What?
What, within the game?
Yes.
Oh my God.
He said, there are payphones throughout the city. I'm like, yes, I've seen the payphones. I've tried to dial some numbers and nothing happened. And he said, but if you look in the city, there are flyers on walls in different places that will tell you about the helpline. And you can go to the phone in the game.
That's awesome.
And dial the helpline.
And did you do it?
I haven't done it yet.
Oh, okay.
But it's still on my list.
Do we need to clarify that for some of our of your younger listeners, maybe?
Sure.
You know, they used to have that back in the day.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
That's
I remember calling the Nintendo. I want to say.
Yeah.
I want to say it was 1-800-422-2602.
Well, so the funny part,
because we dialed that a lot.
The funny story is so to bring it around. Back in the day before there was the internet, when we were young wee lads, as you like to say, Graham, we would get stuck and there would be no place to go to find out what to do. So you'd be able to call this 800 or sometimes it was a 900 number, and God forbid you misdialed the 900 number. That's a whole other conversation. And you would call up and you would get people who would help you through. So, or you could go down to the local store. Now, here's what's interesting. We talk about the Nintendo line. Ryan, who works with us on video, you guys all know Ryan, Triton True on Xbox Live. He used to work it there.
Yeah, because it was near here, wasn't it?
He used to be the guy at the other end with a binder of tips of how to get you through.
No way.
Ask him those stories sometime.
So there is actually, last year, someone sent me a link to a video. I think originally the video was on like a cover-mounted VHS on a video games magazine from the 90s.
Sure.
And it was like a behind-the-scenes look at the Nintendo Powerline office, which right. I believe is near here.
It was right about a mile away.
And it is amazing. Like, if you can find it on YouTube, it's so funny. Because it's like, oh, you know, these guys are video game experts.
Right.
And you know, it's got footage.
So getting back to your thing, Laura. So you saw, by the way, did you ever call into an 800 number?
No, I never did call.
That's, you know why? Because you never got stuck. That's
why.
They
were expensive as well, weren't they?
That's what I'm saying. They
charged you?
Yeah, that's why they were 900 numbers. So I think it'd be 50 cents a minute.
Oh.
If misdialed, then you could be $4 a minute. Trust me.
I hope it would have been
would
a quick
not
question.
Have been
exactly.
So, tip if you're stuck in Thimbleweed Park.
I need you to report back.
Look.
Okay, please. I need you to go dial a number. Let us know what the number is, too.
Yes, I'll let you know what the number is. Okay. Then you dial it in game, and apparently there's a 1980s tree.
Yeah.
To help you
press
through.
One really if you're stuck.
I love
press
that.
Two to place an order.
I thought that was brilliant. So you've heard it directly from a game developer.
From Ron. I should ask him that when we interviewed him a few months ago.
Did you get a photo with him?
No. That was a bit awkward.
Yeah, anything else you guys want to talk about? Anything else about what we're playing? Because we're approaching about 60 minutes now. It's kind of flown by. We're kind of getting back in the saddle here. We got a busy time coming up for the next few months. We've got launch of the Xbox One X coming up in November. We have an unbelievable amount of games being launched. I'm going to be traveling to New York and Los Angeles and all points in between, as I'm sure you will as well, Jeffrey.
Oh, yeah. That's starting Sunday.
So I don't know if you guys have anything else you want to just talk about before we get into the gadget section. We're all chomping the bit about our gadgets.
You know, the one thing I did download and haven't really had a chance to play yet, but I want to see if you've had, was the Mario and Rabbids.
Oh, I need to
Switch.
Get that. It's very much up my alley.
I haven't had a chance. Everyone says it's great.
It passed me, but like, I didn't hear much of the buzz or the hype about it, like through E3 and everything. But then I realized when it launched that it's sort of like XCOM.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So I was like, I'll have to get that then.
Yeah.
So yeah, you will.
I can't wait.
And Mario keeps a shirt on in that one, I'm told.
Did you see that?
Oh, I saw it.
What do you make of that?
Yeah.
How did it make you feel?
Oh, Laura, do you want to see a chestless Mario?
No, thank you.
Okay, that's what I thought.
I did play one unusual game that I was surprised even existed. So there's a lot of games, for whatever reason, that have come out in the last 2 months with the acronym POE. There's been Path of Exile, there's been Pillars of Eternity. I want to say there's two or three. And one of them I was looking at the list of things coming out, and it said Pillars of the Earth. And I'm like, I think I've read a book.
See, now
Pillars of the Earth.
POE means something different to me.
Does it?
Yeah. You know
Prince
what means?
Prison of Elders?
Power over Ethernet. I use that in my house to wire up some cameras.
All right. So, that would have been the ultimate segue if you could have just held it in. Into the gadget section.
Sorry.
Anyway, so this is a book from like 25 years ago. It's huge. It's like 1,000. It's the biggest book I've ever read. And if you're really into the politics of 11th century English monarchy and
tell me more.
And the priesthood. That's right. And architecture. Oh my God, the architecture. That is this book, and it's actually a pretty good book. And
I think
they turned it into
TV
a game
miniseries about it.
With Rufus Sewell. Let me guess. He must be the bad guy.
Him.
Yeah, but he's always the bad guy.
Yeah, but
he's
so
a pretty
good
bad guy,
though, isn't he?
I think it was in it.
For those of you that don't recognize the name, he is from. I'm sorry, I'm blanking.
Man in the High Castle.
Man in the High Castle.
Yeah. He's Uber Gruppenführer.
Yeah, thank you.
No worries.
Well done.
He's so good.
Yeah, he's excellent.
Yeah.
So anyway, they turned that into a game that's very similar to like a Telltale type of story retelling. It's a little bit different, but it was Rufus Sewell, and he's not the bad guy. Spoiler alert. Sorry about that. Donald Sutherland. He's got to be.
Nice.
Also a good bad guy.
Yeah. So anyway, that's a game. Like, I never thought I'd be playing a game. And you do indeed control a monk from the very beginning.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah. So I'm enjoying it. It's not for everyone, but if you read the book, you might be surprised to know there's a game for it. And you might be super into it.
Yeah. Okay. Delightful.
It's very highbrow.
Now you do. Now you know what PoE is.
Now you know what PoE
is.
It also stands for Power Over Ethernet, which is a way to power your devices with just an Ethernet cable, assuming it injects power at the other end. You familiar with that, Laura?
I thought it was the other way around, where you could plug something with the Ethernet into the power, and it gets Ethernet through the power cables.
No, no. Power over Ethernet is like I can run an Ethernet cable to a device that can that is PoE capable, like a camera. So you, when you mount your cameras up, you only have to run one cable, and then you put the power, the Ethernet in this end, and then it has to inject the power to go through. That's all. That's all PoE is.
So what is the thing that I described called?
That is.
I know you have those too.
So that is, well, there's a couple of different things. There's power over, there's Ethernet over power line, which is, I don't use that anymore, but that's something that allows that to happen. That's just different. Whenever you settle, we can talk about networking. I'm the networking nerd.
Okay.
So we'll do
I'll contract you to come in and so, I don't break know. The house up.
Anyway, I've been trying to get to Jeff's house forever. He won't let me in the front door.
Can you cut grass?
You can make my internet faster. You're welcome to come out.
You know how to do that. So yeah, we're talking about gadget section. I don't know. Jeff, you got a new car, Jeffrey.
I did.
You are welcome.
Thank you. Oh, welcome to the zero emissions future.
That's right.
Did you get a Tesla?
I Well, you really took the air out of this one because I didn't. I would love to get a Tesla. Wow. All right. So, well, what happened is
I'm interested, Jeff.
This would be like if I said, I got married. Oh, did you get a 3-carat ring? No. This is happening. No, we're fine. No, so well, I mean, you know, I was interested. There's like the prices are coming down, and I knew I wanted to get an electric car, and my car, which is like 10 years old, was starting to give me trouble, and it was starting to get to the point where I'm like, it's costing me more money to keep this thing going than it does to probably get something new. And you know, I know Larry had gotten
you've been electric for quite some time.
And you had a great experience.
Yeah.
So I went to go. I was like, I'm just going to start looking in this space. And I did look at, you know, Tesla Model 3 looks amazing. Can't get a hold of one for at least a year and a half, something like that,
easily.
If you're not on the list already.
I'm on the list.
Well, there you go. And I'm sure you'll enjoy it.
I have a long way to wait.
So for me, it was all about range.
I'm on the list too. We'll talk about that later.
And the car with the most range that is not a $70,000 Tesla right now is the Chevy Bolt.
That's right.
So I test drove it, and I've never had a Chevy. It wasn't necessary. I never thought I was in the Chevy market for whatever reason. And I ended up buying it. And you know, it's really good. And I tweeted about it. And someone who listens to your show.
Yes, this show right here.
This show, who may be listening right now, was like, thank you for supporting our factory. I know that meant a lot. I was that's really cool.
He works on the assembly line.
Yeah. Oh,
yeah. Yes, yeah.
And I can tell you, it's a great car. Like, I'm really enjoying it. I drove it here. I almost never have to charge the darn thing because you get a ton of range. And there's like a thing where if you're going downhill, it like recharges. I've charged it once, and I've had it for like 2 weeks already. So, nice. Definitely a fan. It's got some really cool futuristic features.
Yeah, it does. It's really nice.
I never had a camera on my car, even for backing up, but it's got cameras all around it, and it has something. If I get too close to other cars, because I'm not that I'd be looking at my phone, that's illegal. But it does let you know if you're getting too close to a car. Nice. Should I ever be distracted? And actually, it has CarPlay and the
it's got everything you'd ever
all
want.
All the things
except. So, things you don't want, which is a gasoline engine. Mm-hmm. Doesn't have that.
It doesn't have that. And the first time I filled up, actually, you showed me the ropes how to fill up on campus. $1.46.
Yeah, we have electric car charging here on the Microsoft campus, as most major companies do now. And Jeff was a little nervous. I said, back it in, pop it open, pop it, it's done.
Yeah. So I mean, as someone like I have a commute, it's about 10 miles. I don't drive a ton. I take the bus as much as I can. It just seemed like a good fit.
Nice.
And you know, I will miss the smell.
Well, are you? What are you going to have for a car when you move? When you because you had your Mini in the UK.
Yeah. And we had a Ford Focus as well. So
okay.
Generally, when people come over from the UK and settle here, they buy the biggest, most ridiculously American car they can get.
Okay.
So I'm willing to follow that trend, to be honest.
Okay. So you haven't made
Escalade.
Really?
No. The higher car we've got is a Ford Explorer.
That's a big vehicle.
It's nuts. Yeah. It's like piloting a cruise
liner. It's like the Queen Mary.
Yeah, but it's, I mean, it's fun. You know, my Mini Cooper was like 12 years old.
He did not edit that in, ladies and gentlemen. That was not the actual Queen Mary. Still, like, I didn't know you had.
A bit like what you were saying, though. Like, my Mini Cooper was 12 years old and had, you know, I loved it, but it had nothing. Whereas this thing is humongous and it's got cameras everywhere. Yeah. It's got, this is how, like, behind the times in cars I am. It's got Bluetooth, which blows my mind because I'm like, oh, I can listen to podcasts from my phone. Oh, my
same thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
What so podcast are you
we're
listening
having
to?
Fun with that.
Oh, yeah, besides this one, of course.
It's Scottish football podcasts. Oh, no one wants to hear any more about that.
That's
really
true.
But they are good.
We'll save it for our soccer.
So when you decide on your vehicle, let us know. We'd love to talk about
it. I will. I think I'm probably going to be boring and go with Fords.
Yeah.
I mean, you know,
it's great cars.
I say boring, but they're great cars.
Yeah.
And I did a thing at Gamescom with Henry Ford III.
Yeah, I remember when I went out to Detroit. Yeah. He's a great guy, isn't he?
Yeah, he's so chilled out.
Yeah,
he's not. I guess you would kind of expect someone like him to be like really intimidating and like. Yeah.
Here's the interesting part about Henry is, I remember when I met him in Detroit, I was introduced to him as this is Henry, and they never said his last name, and I never made the connection.
Yeah.
And then I realized, oh my God, his great grandfather is Henry Ford. He's the Henry Ford.
Yeah.
And you're like, wow, but he's such a delightful gentleman.
And he's like head of marketing for Ford Performance.
For the F.
Right?
For the F.
So maybe he can give you a bit of a discount.
I tried, Jeff. Yeah. Trust me, I tried. And I struck out really badly. I was like, oh yeah, me and my wife drive a Ford Focus. We absolutely love it. We're moving to America soon. We need to get some new cars.
Something a little faster, maybe. We don't really care about trunk space so much.
Nice. Good luck with that.
Anyway, Jeffrey, sorry about that. So
I'm all electric.
Good
I'm all
for
electric.
You.
It's the future.
Living the electric.
There's a lot more. Like while we were just in New York, we had a couple of friends that were in town that were working for doing a gig for. I think it's Kia. Kia just announced it. Actually, a pretty nice looking electric car as well. The Stinger or something like that it's a pretty cool looking car. So
they've had the Soul for a while.
This looks more like the Model 3 almost.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
Anyway, cars. Forza soon. Maybe the Bolt will be in it.
Forza soon.
I could probably look that up.
Can't wait.
What else would you, Laura?
I think you should go next.
Well, I just don't want to follow up to Jeffrey.
Well, no, I didn't want to follow up to you.
So I also have a new car because as discussed earlier, we have a new baby in our life. And so the funny story is my wife called me at Comic-Con when I was at Comic-Con in July. Mm-hmm. She says, hey, you have your electric car and it's a little too small. So we need to get a bigger one because we have the little one coming in a month. She says, I found us a car. Oh boy, here we go. She says, how about we get the Tesla Model X?
Sweet.
I was like, wait, what? So yeah, long story short, is we got the Model X, and that's what it's.
You've nice. Gold wing doors.
No, Falcon.
It drives itself.
Falcon wing.
Falcon wing is more aggressive
than
a gold.
Black.
Bless you,
it is the obsidian black with the tan saddle, the tan leather interior. So
nice,
classy.
Have you tried?
Is it wipe clean?
Pardon me.
Have you tried autopilot yet?
I have. In fact, I used it quite a bit, and it got angry at me, and it shut down.
What?
Apparently, so the Tesla has this autopilot where you can go out if you're using it and it prompts you to, you know, grab the wheel, hey, you're still alive, you're still there. And if you don't do that fast enough three times, it basically shuts down until you pull over to the side of the road and restart the car.
Oh, it shuts down completely.
No, the car doesn't shut down, just the ability to use autopilot is no longer available.
I see.
It's like, nope, we really don't trust you anymore. So you need to pull over to the side of the road and prove that you're really alive.
Wow. Yeah. So, but to be clear, autopilot only works on highways.
I use it whenever I can. So anyway, so I love my Tesla. I'm part of the I'm having a great time. We'll go for a ride in it if you want.
No, I'd love to. Yeah.
So it's a big car. It's
always a highlight of my visit.
It is
here,
a big car. I'll tell you that. But anyway, so that's about that. So yeah, if you're actually, I hate to do this, but if you're in the Tesla family and you want in on the Tesla, let me know and I'll hook you up, right?
Yeah.
Wow.
I'll hook you up with the $1,000 off routine. So send me an email.
Nice.
That's very kind of you. They have that referral program.
Yeah,
so
nice.
Do you have anything you want to talk about, Laura?
So I finally got around to using the Roomba.
Oh, that's right. Did you name the Roomba? I don't recall.
No, he doesn't have a name yet.
Okay.
You should name it after one of those little thieves in Diablo, because you love going into their area.
Yes.
and it sort of like skulks around and steals your dirt. Treasure goblin.
Oh, there you go. The dirt goblin.
The dirt goblin. That's pretty good, actually. But no. And community, I'm disappointed. Nobody gave me any good names.
Okay. So how do you like it, though? Is it cleaning your...
It's significantly improved from a previous version of Roomba that I've had with friends.
Right.
Where it seemed like the algorithm that those old friends. Roombas had...
You buy Roombas with friends? What kind of weird life are you having?
Like... There's a whole lot of things going on that you have no idea.
I was
going to
say, let's unpack that.
So go ahead. Roommates, storm people.
Anyway. Okay, I see.
The old Roombas, they seem to just have the algorithm of, you know, hit a wall, make a random turn, go until you hit a wall, make
random
a
turn,
like random,
and then record what you're doing so you don't do that again.
It probably didn't. Didn't even do that. It probably just completely ran the whole time.
Right.
But this Roomba now understands where it is in the house and tries to create straight lines.
I see.
So, you know, when you are really good at vacuuming, which I'm not. You can make the carpet look really nice by getting the straight lines.
Like when you're cutting the grass.
Yes, yeah. Just like when you're cutting grass, exactly. That's what the Roomba does now, which is pretty cool. It tries to get straight lines.
That's pretty cool.
Okay.
So it's really professional.
Okay.
Professional looking.
Fun.
So your living room looks like a football pitch.
Yeah.
You got to do like the checker style.
The diagonal.
Oh, you know, I don't know if you can program a different pattern. That'd be really awesome.
That would be cool.
If you could do that.
Fun.
The other cool thing that it does is that it sends you notifications about its status. So you have
is it doing that now?
Thinking of you, heart.
LOL.
I really want to clean now. I'm really lonely.
I'm feeling dirty.
Oh, hello.
Wow. There.
That's not where I was going with that.
What? It's a Roomba.
I never got a message like that.
So the first time I turned it on, hours later, I get a notification that says, Roomba is stuck.
Oh, no.
Go save it.
Oh, no.
Help me.
Were you at work?
Yes.
And what, so you stop the meeting. You say, I've got to go. My Roomba needs me.
I'm sorry.
Got a domestic emergency.
Yes.
That would stress me out.
So what happened?
To pick up the little one.
Got home.
Where was it?
First you had to go hunting for the Roomba.
So like, in a panic, where's my Roomba? Exactly. And you can't call it because it can't go beep, beep, beep.
So I'm looking all over the house trying to find this Roomba. Of course, it's always the last place you look. But it was like 5 minute search. And the bathroom door was closed.
Yes.
So tried to open the bathroom door, and as soon as you pressed on the...
You felt resistance.
It was good. Error 17. Pushing up against the door.
Error Leave me alone,
17.
Mom.
Error 17.
I'll come out when I'm ready.
Amazing. That is amazing.
Oh, boy.
It had gotten itself stuck in the bathroom.
Well, who hasn't, really?
That's fair. And I felt really bad for the poor Roomba.
So
was out of battery because he had been trying to get out of the small little bathroom.
We've all run it.
Did it have some candles lit and a glass of wine?
was it heaved over the toilet? Was with the bucket?
Get it a bucket.
Sick. Yeah, getting back to the bucket.
The old dipsy doodle on that one, man.
So pick it up and carry it back to its charger.
So have you told it, don't go in there again?
Oh, no.
Because you got to put up those little lighthouses.
Oh, that's right. There are the lighthouses.
Right? And you can put them up and say which are basically say, don't go here.
Mm-hmm. So. I can just close the bathroom door. And
that's probably that too. That's low-tech solution.
Low-tech, but it'll work.
Low-tech.
Now, maybe this is getting too personal. Mm-hmm. But, you know, do you ever have a situation, maybe you're in the doing your business in the bathroom and leave the door? Maybe it bumps the door and wants to come in with you?
Oh,
does it have separation anxiety?
This is so much.
Yeah.
Come and find me in the house.
Beep.
I'm here.
Error help. Error help. Oh, dear.
No, but it's a fantastic machine. It cleans really well. It cleans better than normal.
Just not the bathroom.
But not the bathroom because we can't let it in there.
So that's interesting. Okay. Yeah, so Roomba. Which one do you have?
I can't remember.
The Snooper?
It's like the top of the line one.
It's the one that gets stuck. And it doesn't have a name. It's a nameless Roomba. Mm-hmm. It's terrible.
Poor little guy.
Now, so this is, we talked about... Do you have anything else, Laura?
No.
Okay.
That's more than enough.
Because I was thinking about this earlier this week, is that this is kind of the, getting into the, at least in the Northern Hemisphere, the fall, this is like the season of the X. So we've got Xbox One X coming.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, iPhone X, or I think they call it iPhone 10. They don't really call it X, but it's is there any other products I'm missing? But we were first to the gate on this one, I'll tell you.
Yes.
Right?
It's not the Xbox One 10.
No, it's the Xbox One X.
Yes.
What do you think of those new phones, Jeffrey? Laura and I were having.
I'll have to see. I want to see it in person. I think you got to see it in person. and to really know. The thing that I want is I want wireless charging. My mm-hmm. my car has wireless charging.
Where is
built
the pad?
I'll show it to you. Yeah, it's like a little pocket that the phone goes into, and it will theoretically
charge. Now you have to upgrade.
I feel like for science, for science,
yeah. Right?
I should probably do that.
Fine. Anyway, we'll see.
Wireless charging is pretty sweet. It's terrible to try and plug in your phone when it's dark.
It's a first world problem.
And I just set it on the wireless pad and it starts charging.
Bleep. Mm. Weep, weep.
Yep.
Anyway, we'll see.
Star Wars, is there Star Wars X? Well. Star Wars episode IX? Mm. IIX? Or is it VIII?
Maybe, I don't know.
I don't really. The Romans. I. There's a reason the empire fell. And it was the numbers.
At Jeff Rubenstein on Twitter.
I didn't mean it, Justinian.
The Romans are going to be so angry with you.
Oh boy. All right. I think we should probably wrap up now.
I think we should.
Because we've gone, the numbers have rolled over. We've gone so far. So I don't know how long the show is. But anyway, Graham, welcome to the U.S. on behalf of everybody here. Yeah. And welcome to the U.S. And thank you
for some tips for you.
Thanks.
You're welcome to come on the show as frequently or infrequently as you'd like to. Now, he hasn't done so to this point, but on Jeff's behalf, I will invite you to his Saturday morning football.
Right,
because he goes to the bar.
This is the biggest adjustment, is all of the football, it's a breakfast thing. You put on a pot of coffee.
Amazing.
And then you have, you maybe have a full English, occasionally. I did have one. I'm still not sure what black pudding is. Yeah. I only ate a little bit of it.
Wikipedia.
On Saturday morning, super jet lagged, like everyone was up at 1 a.m. or whatever. I was watching Man City Liverpool at like 4 a.m. or 5 a.m. On Saturday morning. But just really quickly on this one, one of the best unexpected bonuses about coming here is that, I love Aberdeen Football Club, right? I can watch every Aberdeen game on the official Aberdeen, internet TV website.
Right.
Every game in full, live.
Right.
At 7 a.m. on a Saturday morning.
There you go.
That is, and then you have your whole weekend ahead of you.
Right, I'm coming to America.
Yeah.
Because I can watch all the football
It's
games.
Actually easier to watch here than it is
it's
there.
It's ridiculous. Yeah. I mean, I can understand why they do it. They've got all these blackouts and everything, but... Yeah. It's gonna be great. I'm gonna be able to watch every single
Yay,
game.
Yay, America.
I know. The farther I go away from Aberdeen, the more I can watch them.
That makes
sense. That does make sense.
Yay for licensing. All right, gang. Laura, thank you for seeing. For those of you that are picked up on this, we're at the end of the show, but we didn't do Name the Game.
Oh, we didn't?
We didn't, because we're just gonna reheat the other one, so go back and listen to the last one.
Okay.
How about we do that?
Yeah, we did kind of run out of time.
Yeah, we ran out of time.
So much to talk about.
We had Graham here, which we just got completely we'll blame you.
You already get blamed.
So
always blame the Scotsman. That's where you'll learn about the United States.
Yeah. Always blame the
Scotsman. At Jeff Rubenstein.
Here has been fun.
All right, they can find Laura. They can find you on social media.
That's right. You can find me on Twitter at Laura Lollipop.
Graham.
On Twitter at AC Bongos and Instagram as well.
Yeah, that's right. Look for those beautiful photos. Yes, those highly stylized photos. You can find me, Major Nelson. Of course, Jeffrey, you can find
You went first. I couldn't say. Direct all complaints to Major Nelson at Jeff Rubenstein.
Direct all complaints. Be gentle there. So, anyway. All right, gang. We'll see you next week when we see you. Thanks for everything. We'll talk to you soon. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
You want to say goodbye, Graham?
Bye.